joining me on this issue, because he has also asked for some clarity and answers on this. It's Congressman Jim Jordan from the great state of Ohio. He's fresh in, hot off the floor. He's been running around D.C. serving his constituents and America. Congressman, good to see you. That was a very unclear answer that Kirby just gave
there.
What can you tell us about this? Because I don't ever remember a hold like this being placed on an ammunition sale to an ally in the Middle East like this, ever.
I don't remember this either, particularly our dearest and closest friend, the state of Israel. But frankly, it's kind of consistent with what we've been hearing from the White House. Go back to the State of the Union a few weeks ago when Joe Biden stood there in the House chamber and said, we're going to put a temporary pier, a port in Gaza to give supplies to Gaza. And I was sitting beside a colleague of mine, actually a former West Point graduate, and I said, isn't it kind of basic warfare? If you want one side to win, you don't give supplies to the other side? I mean, what are we doing here? Israel's our best friend. Let's help them win. And you help them win by not supplying their enemy and by sending the ammunition that they're supposed to receive from the United States. So I don't get what Mr. Kirby was saying there, and I certainly don't get what Joe Biden's doing.
Yeah, and that on the heels of the other story that came out discussing this compromise that I guess Hamas negotiated with itself with the help of Qatar and in Egypt, and they came out and said that they agreed to it. Well, the details that are coming out about this and apparently the involvement of the Biden administration, he apparently sent a CIA, one of the CIA officials over to help take part in these negotiations. I don't know if it was in Doha or where, but 33 hostages, dead or alive. So you could just hand over 33 dead hostages, and I guess that they would get full credit for that. And then there was also the guarantee that there would be no more hostilities on the side of Israel, but nothing for Hamas. I mean, and Hamas would still retain control of Gaza. I could completely understand, Congressman, why Israel rejected that.
Yeah, here's an idea, Dana. Why don't we just help Israel win? They were attacked in October. It was a terrorist organization who did the terrible things to Jewish citizens, to Jewish people in Israeli city, to our best friend. Why don't we just let them win and help them win, for goodness sake? They're the good guy. We know who the bad guy is. I want the good guys to win. But unfortunately, you're getting all kinds of mixed signals from the Biden administration. And I think it's driven by the fact that the hard left now controls their party, and they're concerned about presidential politics instead of helping our dearest and closest ally, the state of Israel, prevail against terrorism.
Do you feel, Congressman, that the administration has forgotten about the American hostages that Hamas has?
I don't know. I was asked a few weeks ago about the Biden administration. Some reporter asked me, is there anything good you can say about the Biden administration? And I actually gave it a few seconds. I thought about it, and I said, no, there isn't, because I don't know what they've done right. You can go through all the issues, and they certainly haven't handled foreign policy in a smart way, in my judgment, in a positive way, in a way that's been good for our allies and, frankly, good for the United States. So I just don't know. I just don't know what they're up to.
It seems maybe that they're, which is interesting, because Biden was always promised to be this foreign policy, this respected statesman. You know, that's why he was put on the Obama ticket. Maybe it's because they're spending so much time looking at domestic issues like censoring speech. I know that you've demanded answers from Amazon, talking with Congressman Jim Jordan, because it seems, and this is so wild to me, that the Biden administration was pressuring Amazon to essentially suppress sales of any kind of publication that were critical of it. This is like 1984 and 2024.
Yeah, a virtual book burning, virtual book banning, do not promote certain books that disagreed with the administration's position. And this was on the heels of Biden administration pressuring Twitter to take down certain posts, the Biden administration pressuring Facebook to take down certain content, the Biden administration pressuring YouTube to take down certain videos. So it's on the tail of all that. They said, not to be outdone, we actually want them to do not promote certain books. Most of the books they want to not promoted on Amazon were the ones that questioned their approach to dealing with COVID. Because, you know, Dana, they were right about everything, right? You know, think about it. They told us it wasn't gain-of-function research in the lab in China. They said it wasn't our money used as a spin in the lab in China. Both those are wrong. They said it didn't come from a lab. I always joke, no, it was a bat to a pangolin to a hippopotamus, and then we all get COVID. They said masks work. They said the vaccinated couldn't get it. The vaccinated couldn't transmit it. There are seven lies right there. So, but they were telling Amazon, take down, don't promote certain books, and all these other social media platforms to take down content. It's frightening what they were up to. particularly when it's a violation of the First Amendment to censor false speech. But these guys were wrong. They were actually trying to censor things that were true, which I think just sort of adds insult to injury.
The erosion of excellence in America poses a serious threat to both our lives and the future of our great nation. Under the guise of promoting diversity, standards are being systematically lowered across various critical fields, such as medicine, engineering, science, and law. It's terrifying. Take, for example, the recent decision by the American Medical Association to associate medicine with white supremacy, leading to the lowering of standards on medical school entrance tests. And this trend is not limited to medicine alone. For more insight on this issue, I encourage you to read the latest issue of In Primis, a thought-provoking publication from Hillsdale College. In Primis gives you insightful constitutional commentary from leading conservative thinkers, people like Chris Rufo, Victor Davis Hanson, Heather McDonald, and Hillsdale's president, Larry Arnn. You can receive a complimentary subscription at dana4hillsdale.com, and there's absolutely no cost or obligation. Hillsdale College is committed to promoting liberty through education, and In Primis is a testament to that mission. Sign up today at dana4hillsdale.com.
That's a very good point, talking with Congressman Jim Jordan. I mean, this wasn't even anything that was libelous or defamatory. I mean, it was stuff that was absolutely accurate about their non-entirely scientific approach to the virus and the lockdowns and what worked and what didn't work. So does that mean at some point, and I mean, I realize I'm getting like real far ahead in the timeline of how this stuff plays out, but I would imagine that if people can prove that they were, you know, damaged, book sales were damaged by this, that seems like that's a pretty big class action suit against the administration and Amazon.
Yeah, good question. Good. I mean, who knows? We'll try to find out. I'm sure the people who wrote some of those books and found out that they were on the do not promote list or they were suppressed somewhat, they'll want to check all that out. The other question I have is, what are they doing now in the run up? We're now less than 6 months before the most important election we have, election of who's going to be our commander in chief. And what are they doing now? What kind of pressure there are they trying to exert on social media companies and or Amazon or anyone else to censor speech that they disagree with? We're trying to find that answer out as well.
Yeah, that's the key point there, because it seems like we always find out what they're up to after the election, after votes are cast, after things happen, and then we see all of the moves that they have been making. It all comes to light. And speaking of that, you have opened up an inquiry, talking with Congressman Jim Jordan. You've opened up an inquiry into the DEI hiring standards of the FBI after whistleblowers have been sounding the alarm on recruitment practices. I did not realize that as a country, we were so safe and secure that we could now start focusing with these enforcement agencies, Congressman, on DEI practices.
Let's just hire the best people. Let's just hire the people who can do the job. Let's make sure the FBI stays what it's always has been, the premier law enforcement body, because I still think the vast majority of the rank and file agents are good people. At the top now, that's a different story. I think there are folks here in Washington who are focused on politics and a double standard and going after their political opponents. That's where the problems are really at. So let's make it that way across the. Let's hire the best people. But the Biden administration has come in and said, we want this DEI across the government and every single agency, including the FBI. And frankly, we've heard about it from my colleagues on the Armed Services Committee that the same thing is happening to the military. That respected institution that Americans, you know, have so much respect for our men and women in uniform. Let's don't do it there either. Let's just have the best people. Let's get the folks who are going to do the job the way that they should.
Yeah, exactly. The way that they need to do it. And that's, I think you made a really, that's a key point in that it's, I agree with you. It's not all of the FBI, the rank and file, because that's where the whistleblowers are coming from. Rank and file
FBI.
Yes, they're good guys.
They come forward and tell, we had them come forward before we took control back in January of last year. And they've come, several whistleblowers come talk to us about all kinds of issues. And God bless them for doing so. So we want those good agents coming in and doing the right thing.
And that's brave of them to do it, because aren't they being pretty severely penalized as a result of this?
Yeah, there's been retaliation, not only there, but we actually think the two whistleblowers from the IRS, they're being retaliated against for sure by the Internal Revenue. This Mr. Shapley, Mr. Ziegler, who came forward and gave us all this information on how the Hunter Biden investigation was being run in such a crazy way, not consistent with how they normally do investigations. And they've been retaliated against, which is against the law. So we're looking into that issue as well.
what consequences for these people that are breaking the law by trying to silence whistleblowers through this intimidation and these threats of, you know, this the punitive consequence? What can be done about this?
Well, I mean, the Justice Department is supposed to prosecute. If you retaliate, supposed to prosecute people who do that, you know, that kind of behavior, that kind of retaliation against people who followed the law and came forward and gave us information that was important for Congress to have and for the country to have. But we'll see if Merrick Garland's Justice Department does that. I'm not holding my breath.
Yeah, not holding your breath. Well, I wouldn't either, because, right, I mean, we can't even apparently hold people like Mayorkas accountable either. I want to ask you a quick question about House leadership, because I know you're focused on the big fish out there. I feel like a lot of, you know, I hear from people all across the country. We're in hundreds of different affiliates, and we have our online streaming as well. And it does, people feel like the fight over House leadership is a distraction. Do you kind of share that sentiment with the folks across the country?
Yeah, we're less than 6 months before, you know, the presidential election. We need President Trump back in the White House now more than ever. I think he's the best president, certainly in my lifetime. We need him back in there. I mean, Joe Biden's been in there. We got Hamas attacking Israel. We got Russia moving into Ukraine. You didn't have that with President Trump. So not to mention all the stuff on domestic policy. So we need him back in the White House. Let's stay focused on that. Winning the White House, keeping the House, taking back the United States Senate. Let's stay focused on that. That's what we should be doing, not changing, not having a third speaker in one
with
Congress.
Barely a one-seat majority. My fear is that, you could see a Speaker Jeffries. I just feel like Murphy's Law will come into play here, and that kind of scares me.
Yeah, we don't want that.
Do not want that. Congressman Jim Jordan, we always appreciate our time with you. Thank you so much for working so hard on behalf of Americans. Good to talk with
Thanks
you.
Thanks for what you do.
Of course,
take care.
You too. Thanks for watching The Dana Show. Make sure to like, subscribe, ring the bell, and stay tuned for more content.